Amen. Welcome this morning to Second Night of Ministry. It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
It's not raining. It's beautiful. Right. It's yes. Sunny out. Yes. We love the rain, but that sun sure feels good.
Huh?
Yes. Amen. If you're able to this morning, let's stand as we get ready to enter into praise and worship and to give them all our praise and give them all our worship this morning. Heavenly Father, we come before you, Lord, and we thank you, Father God, once again, Lord, for another day, another time, and another opportunity, Father, to worship you, Father God, together corporately, Father God, one mind, one body, one spirit, Father God, to worship you, Lord. Oh, Lord, in spirit and in truth, Father God, because we are true worshipers of you. Thank you for seeing our hearts this morning, Father God. As we lay them all down, Father God, we lay our crowns at your feet this morning, Lord, and we worship you, Father God. So we thank you this morning, Father God, for your goodness, for your mercies. We renew every morning, Father God, and we thank you, Lord. We pray for those that are on their way, Lord. We pray for those who are sick in body, Father God, that you would just touch their bodies right now, Lord. Heal them from the top of their head to the sole of their feet. And we pray for those watching us in home, that you would heal their heart with your presence, Lord. And Lord, we give this time to you from beginning to end. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Lord, you are good this morning. Amen. Hallelujah.
How many of you are ready to worship?
Good and your mercies endure forever. Lord, you are good and your mercies endure forever. Lord, you are good. Lord, you are good and your mercies endure forever. Lord, you are good and your mercies endure forever.
People from every nation.
People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are.
Oh, come on, put your hands together.
We worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. You are good.
You are good.
Lord, you are good and your mercies endure forever. Lord, you are good and your mercies endure forever. Lord, you are good and your mercies endure forever. Lord, you are good and your mercies endure forever.
People from every nation.
People from every nation and tongue, from generation to generation, we worship you.
Hallelujah,
hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are. Oh, we worship you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, we worship you for who you are.
These words.
You are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good all the time, all the time. You are good, you are good all the time, all the time. You are good.
People from every nation.
People from every nation and tongue. From generation to generation, we worship you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We worship you. For who you are.
Wasn't feeling good, so I had to break out one of the drum guys in here.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Thank you. We worship you, Lord. We thank you, God, for this time together. Thank you, God, for who you are, God, here this morning. Father, we thank you, God, for your healing. power. We thank you, God, for touching us. You hold my every moment. You calm my raging seas. You walk with me through fire and heal all my disease. And I trust in you, and I trust in you, and I trust in you. I believe you're my healer, and I believe you're my healer, and I believe you are all I need. Jesus, I believe, and I believe you're my portion, and I believe you're more than enough for me. Jesus, you're all I need. First one, you hold my every moment. He calms your raging seas. You calm my raging seas. You walk with me through fire. You walk with me through fire and heal all my disease. And I trust in you, and I trust in you. I trust in you, and I trust in you. I believe you're my healer, and I believe you're my healer, and I believe you are all I need. Jesus, I believe you're my portion, and I believe you're my portion, and I believe you're more than enough for me. Jesus, you're all I need. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. We thank you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. Father, we put our trust in you here this morning, God. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Whatever you're facing here this morning, just give it to the Lord here this morning. Worship you, Lord, here this morning, God. Would you touch your people here this morning, God? Let them sense your presence here, God. We thank you, God.
Healing is here. Healing is here. Healing is here. I receive it all. Healing is here. Healing is here. Your healing is here.
Father, I pray right now, Lord, for each and every one of us in here today, Lord, that might have a need, might be going through something, Lord, privately, Lord, in your own way, Lord, just touch them right now, right where they're at. I pray, Father God, that you continue to bring, Father God, us as a country back to you, Lord, that we would repent, Father God, and turn back and follow your ways, Lord. Teach us to follow you, Lord. I pray today, Lord, that we can have victory, Lord, but only through Christ Jesus, our Lord and our Savior. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Jesus' name. Amen. Give the Lord a praise offering. Turn around, greet someone in the name of the Lord, and you may be seated. Hallelujah.
Bless you guys, God bless you. Bless each and every one of you here today. Amen. We're going to get ready to collect our offering. We welcome everybody to Second Adam Ministry. God's in the house, amen. How many had a wonderful Resurrection Easter Sunday?
Amen.
It was blessed. It rained. Did it rain? It rained a little bit in the morning. Now it was pretty good in the afternoon. They're really nice, but what a wonderful day. What a beautiful day that we can proclaim the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to get ready to collect our offering. So if you'd like to give the offering the old-fashioned way, just raise your hand. We'll pass you an envelope out. And if you need to give it that way, if you'd like to give through twoadamministries.org, you can do that way. Give it through the Tithe app. And everything you give is tax deductible. If you need that at the end of the year, just let me know, and we'll be happy to supply you with that information. And once again, we thank you for your giving to the ministry so we can do everything that God has called us to do. Amen. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. Lord, we thank you for the offering. Lord, we thank you for meeting every one of our needs according to your riches and glory. Lord, bless us as we go from glory to glory, line upon line, and faith upon faith, Lord, to do what you called us to do, Lord. Bless your family, Lord, the family, the people of God, to be blessed in their finances. Give them the wisdom, Lord, to how to budget their money, how to take care of their money, Lord, that they can do everything that they desire to do for the kingdom of God and for their families. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 As we go forward, we know that life is difficult. In California, they closed all the 99-cent stores. Don't even get me started so I get kicked off on Facebook and will. But, when the government doesn't know how to run a business, they're setting prices that they don't understand what the small business owner goes through. I can remember during the COVID, don't get me started on that, that they were opening the restaurants, closing the restaurants, but they didn't understand that you can't hold the meat and hold the eggs for a certain amount of time. They go bad. So they're stuck. The restaurant owners are stuck with holding food. They had to throw them away. They lost money. So when you don't know what you're doing, when you say $20 an hour, well, why not make it $50 an hour? Because they don't understand that the margin of profit to make money for a company is reinvested back into their businesses.
Right. Yep.
And the owner, he accrues all the damages, everything. Everything that goes on, he does it. How many own their own business? Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. How many punch a time clock in and you go home, you don't worry about it?
Mm-hmm.
You don't worry about it.
Right.
You don't worry about meeting payroll. You don't worry about insurance. You don't worry about any of those things. And that's what we've done here in the state of California. We're having people that do things that do not know what they're doing. They don't know what they're doing. And they're driving businesses out of business. They're closing down. And we have to pray that God would send, I would even say, godly people, just smart people. There's some business type people that could take care of California, and I guarantee you, California is a beautiful state.
Amen.
Beautiful state, but man, we are just ruining it. I took myself for a drive yesterday downtown. I was like in third world country, all by those freeways. And I'm here to tell you today that your pastor was going to show up with a 2024 Yukon. I went to go look for it. And I went to go look for it. And I was like, all right, let's go. Because my daughter and my son-in-law, they love stuff. You know? And I go, yeah, my son and I deserve a new car, new truck, Yukon, and everything. Well, guess what? That car that I wanted cost $80,000.
Oh.
It's all right. I had the money for it. But thanks, because I'm going to collect another offering afterwards. I wouldn't do that yet, but no. But what happened was, you realize that I could afford it, but the ARP is 7.9%. The interest rate is 7.9%. Putting $10,000 down, $20,000 down, that payment was still $1,800, $1,500, $1,200.
I'm good.
I said, no, I'm good. I go, once we get some straight, good business people in California, I told the guy, I'll be back. That's my car I'm going to get. I'm going to get that car. But my credit's good. I go, I ain't paying. Once it gets down to 2%, 3% on the air, wow. Look at people. You can put that in. That payment should not be that much.
No.
Not that much. That's crazy. So I'm here to tell you today that I want you to be a giver. But I also, first of all, want you to be disciplined in your own finances at your house. Get your house in order financially. I can't emphasize that enough. We don't know who's going to win these elections. We don't know anything that's going to happen. I have a hunch, I have a feeling, and I pray that it turns out that way. But you need to be prepared in your finances. You need to be prepared because you never know. The dollar is going down. The dollar is worth less. And if you're not wise in your finances, you can't afford to get those Vegas runs. I'm going to take my honey out for a bit. No, you don't need to go to Vegas. You go outside on your front porch and get a little hibachi there and run around, feed your dog, put a little, put some sort of lion's thing on, said you went to the circus. Disneyland is ridiculous.
I know,
it's like thousands of dollars, but hey, you do your thing. You know, that's what I'm telling you. You know, for those of you who drink the devil's tail, you drink the devil's blood. The devil's blood, when you go to the baseball game, that's $18 to $20. It's expensive. And you can't say God has not blessed you when you have not used wisdom in your life.
Yes.
We need to repent when it comes to how we use our money.
Yes.
And say, God, show me how to use my money. I mean, that's not my sermon today. I just had to tell you that I'm a broken man because I couldn't get that. it was a Yukon, ART, ATR, something like that. It was like, boom, top of the line. I was like, I had my grandson in one seat, my son in the other seat. We had it all planned out. And nope. We just walked out. But amen. Real quick, we're going to get ready to dismiss our kids to class. If you'd like to go to class, but it's there. And once again, we still need teachers. And again, if you have children, bring them to church. We will teach them and give them the Word of God and all that good stuff. But on Monday, I do my pastor's playbook. 12:20 every Monday, we just go over some of the things that we talked about. We go over some of the things that are happening in the work of the Lord. We just encourage you guys to keep striving for the Lord. These are not my glasses. My son, my grandson, he broke my glasses. So these are little cheap glasses, the reading glasses that I got from Friday. So if I take them off and on, they give me a headache. But a couple things that I've learned, that you always got to prepare your life, get yourself ready for life.
Yeah.
I went to the dentist this week. As I went to the dentist, the funny thing was I thought I was good. My teeth were like, all right, my teeth are good. Man, how many know what about this when they start calling out numbers? One is very low, right? 1 to 5, 5 is bad. Well, a couple years ago, I hadn't been to the dentist, but I was at the dentist and she got me all cleaned up, everything. So she's yelling out 1s and 2s and everything. And I'm like, oh, I got there today, 3s, 4s. I'm like, what am I doing? I'm doing the same things. And I said, okay, I got to make sure I'm doing it. It's the same thing with the Word of God.
Yeah.
You think you're doing fine. You think you're doing good. You're casual. Whatever I'm doing, I must have been slipping, because those I got very low, very few 2s in my mouth. A lot of 3s, a lot of 4s, and a lot of, there's a bleeding back here. I'm like, bleeding? What's going on here? Think about our spiritual life, how much. There's a lot of 3s and 4s, right, in our lot, in our mouths, and we just, no big deal. Then I went to the eye doctor. Eye doctor, I passed with flying colors. All right, I made it. But I'm here to tell you today that if you're not self-evaluating yourself, you're shortchanging your life. We should never be satisfied with our life. We should be content where we're at, but we should never be satisfied, because God moves us forward each and every day of our lives. You and I are moving forward in our lives. You know, every other Tuesday, Brother Richard has his Clear Eyes on in ministries, and it's to help you move forward in your life if you're addicted to whatever you're addicted to, whatever, if you want to talk things through, he's there for you to help out. We've got the group of guys that come on out. Ladies, you're welcome. Wednesday night, we have our Bible study, Following Christ, every Wednesday night for the month of April. Come out every Wednesday. It's an hour. We get into the Word of God, and we discuss how to grow in Christ. Thursday, we have our food bank, and our food bank has been nothing but a blessing. People are tough. You know, tough times. We have to get tougher in standing for God, and the people are coming out, and we need to bless them. So if you want to help us, come at 7:45, 8 in the morning on Thursday. Help load us up and get us ready. And then at 5 o'clock, we come and we just hand out the food. We hand out clothes. If you have clothes you'd like to donate, bring some good stuff. Don't be bringing your oh my God, I'm going to get rid of this stuff. Don't do that. Because I will bring them up on Sunday morning.
No.
So this is what you gave us. Don't do that. You can't fit into it, so you're giving it away. All right, that's what it's about. All right, whether you're chubby or skinny, you can't fit in no more. You're giving it away. Amen. There's some clothes we get, there's still tags on them. So it's a great ministry. It really is. It's fun when you come out for the food bank. Brother Scott came in. He pinched hit for us. His mom was in line, right? He came. He helped us all the way through. Just helped get it done. And then once she was up at the line, he took off. We were pretty much gone through the line. So come on out, help. We have a great time fellowshipping with one another every other Thursday. And then Sunday morning, we have our Sunday morning services, and we have a great time. There's nothing like being here live Sunday morning. Every other Sunday, you still have a chance to come to our Bible class, and I teach you the background of the Bible. I teach you how to study the Word of God every other Thursday. And I'm building preachers here. I'm building people how to study the Word of God, how to teach the Word of God, because I need help, people to teach and preach, but you got to be called to do it. You can study all you want. If there's not a calling on your life, you ain't going to get up there. But there's something that you have in your life. There's a bunny. Like brother, where's Brother Robert at? Brother Robert, Brother Robert's going to be a preacher.
Sweet. Amen.
He's bubbling, but I gotta slow Brother Robert down. Brother Robert has to get going. Amen. Sunday morning, every other Sunday. Amen. Every other Sunday. So not this Sunday, the following Sunday. We give homework and we have a class there, and it's ongoing. And come on out. And it's structured. And I break down how to study the Greek, the Hebrew, background, context, pretext, hermeneutics, all that good stuff. So we get into the Word of God there every other Sunday. Okay, that's all I have. Let's get into the Word of God today. And Let's preach today. I'm here to chat today. There's kids who like to go to this class. Brother Gus will teach the class. He's not only a bass player. He's one of our Sunday school teachers. I'm here tomorrow to tell you that we're going to have an eclipse tomorrow. Don't spiritualize it that much. Okay? There's an eclipse that's supposed to happen. Let it happen. Okay? Dad, what was that one thing that everyone was going crazy about? The moon was going to be bloody, or the sun was going to be bloody. Remember that one a couple years ago?
The blood moon.
Remember the blood moon? Remember everyone was freaking out with the blood moon? Yes. And my dad pulled me over to the side. He goes, "Mijo, that doesn't mean that, because the rest of the verse says the other part of it is the moon, the sun was going to be blocked out too." So you may have one part, but you don't have the other part. I'm here to tell you today there was someone that said in Exodus chapter 4, verse 8, they were saying, because Exodus 4, 8 says this, because the number 4 and the number 8, you got to be careful for numerology as well when you study the Word of God, because the Word of God was not written with chapters and verses. Okay? So when you see something, a prophecy of numerology, what says here in Exodus 4:8, that something's going to happen here and here. There was no, in the original text, there is no numbers. They put numbers by the time the King James 15th, 16th century, that's when they started breaking them up into chapters and verses for better readability. Okay? Do I need to cut the low offering for that little thing I gave you guys? Get my down payment? All right. Look at Brother Eric, because I'm going to go on another ride overnight. I'm going to buy my truck right now. So if you get past that money, you get that new truck. So tomorrow, don't freak out, okay? You serve the Lord, whether there's an eclipse or there isn't an eclipse, okay? You trust God either way. Amen?
Amen.
He says, it is our little faith that hinders us. Plain and simple. There are things in our lives that hinder us. There are things that happen that could cause us either to grow in Christ or to take a step back. And what we were talking about in Matthew chapter 6, we were talking about you can't serve two masters. You can't worry about what you're going to wear, what you're going to eat, because God's going to take care of you. If you took care of the birds in the air, if you took care of the lilies in the field, He's going to take care of you.
Sure.
How much more valuable are you than all these things?
Right.
Even Solomon, in his great power and glory, God is going to take care of you even better. Amen?
Amen.
So he says, you can't serve two masters. You're going to either serve God or you're going to serve money. You're either going to serve the world or you're going to serve me. And the world, a lot of times, wins because what we see, that's what we go after. That's why we're a lot in financial ruin or financial debt, is because we go after the very thing that our eyes see. Amen?
Amen.
You know, there's an old saying, I'd rather have a dollar bag with $5,000 in it than have a $5,000 bag with only a dollar in it. You'll get that at 2 in the morning.
Yeah.
All you guys want to get your Gucci, Moochies, and Poochies bags and all that stuff, right? Y'all want to wear your Air Jordans? You, instead of being practical, go get yourself some Chucks. Get yourself some Chuck Taylors. $40, $50, man.
Ouch.
You spending $200, $200 on a pair of shoes? You have when that offering plate comes, you have alligator on? You got to go like this? I can't. Then when it's time to go out to eat with everybody after church or somewhere, and you know you haven't paid no money for it, you get an alligator arms when that check comes. Because you're spending money that you shouldn't be spending money on. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So think about all the things that the world gets into. Now, I'm all for fine stuff. Amen. But not like, even like my daughter, yesterday when we were looking at that truck, oh, man, There was a golden calf being built right there. I knew about to worship that car. It was beautiful. And so she looked at the number. She looked at that. She goes, what are you tripping at? It's only $700, not $17. She goes, and then I looked up and I saw the other numbers. And then she goes, and then she picked up her son and they started walking up. This is way too much money. And I think a lot of times what we do things is through pride. We want to look like the Joneses or the Garcias or the Sanchez's. We want to look like everybody else instead of saying, God, help me be wise in what I have. So we can't serve two masters. We can only serve either God or man. And God will show you what to do with your money. Amen?
Amen.
God will show you how to handle your relationship. When you learn to turn everything over to the Lord, trust Him. Amen. So let's get up down to verse 30. And then we're going to take a running this through the scriptures here. Matthew 6:30. Do you have that beer?
Oh, I'm sorry. You got it, sorry.
Okay. So we're in Matthew, right? Matthew 6:30. Now God clothes the grass of the field, which today is and tomorrow is thrown into the oven. Will He not much more clothe you, O ye a little faith? Okay, so the first thing God wants to do is to trust Him. And the little bit of the clothes we have, styles come and styles go. Amen?
Amen.
They come in. First we had the really baggy stuff in the 1900s. In the 19th century, the 1990s, right? That feels a long time ago, huh?
Amen.
1990 was like close to 30 years ago. Wow. And then the 2000s were baggy stuff. Suits were big, right? And all of a sudden, everybody wanted to look like Pee Wee Herman.
How about it?
Rudy's going back to the 70s about Stacey Adams, right? But he said, I want you to understand that greediness cheapens our riches as well as us. When we concentrate on the things of this world, it cheapens us.
Amen.
Because it diminishes our relationship with God. God wants to supply all of your needs. God wants to take care of you. Amen?
Amen.
God wants to work through your life. But when you focus so much on the things of this world, you start looking for the world to source you out. And God wants to be your source and your sustainer. It says, therefore, do not worry. Verse 31, therefore, do not worry, saying, what shall we eat? What shall we drink? Or what shall we wear? Fill your life with God. For all these things the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. God knows what you need.
Amen.
How many believe that this morning? God knows what you need.
Amen.
Can I get an amen in here?
Amen.
God knows what you need.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen.
He knows what you need. When you wake up in the morning, God knows what you need. When you lay down at night, God knows what you need. I'm here to tell you today that you can depend on God.
Amen.
I'm here to tell you today that you can trust God. Like that little baby, that infant baby under a year old, 2 years old, that baby is dependent on mommy and daddy to meet all their needs. I'm here to tell you today that you can depend on God.
Amen.
You can cry unto the Lord and God will answer you. God will show up in your life.
Amen. Amen.
I hear that beautiful cry of 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 in the morning. That baby is crying. And then the uncle wants to chime in. And he starts making noise in his room. And I know that I got to get to go. Because I'm their father. I'm their grandfather.
Amen.
And I know what they're in need of. See, in your life, you have to trust God. That God knows what you're in need of. God knows what is happening in your life. What he says here, for all these things the Gentiles seek. What he means by that in verse 31, 32 says, for the Gentiles act this way. You know what he means by that? He's putting them down. Gentiles mean unbelievers. Gentiles mean
barbarian. Gentile means people that don't have a covenant with God. That's what Gentiles mean. It says you and I, we have a covenant. How many have a covenant with the Lord Jesus
Amen.
Christ?
Amen.
Because of the blood of Jesus Christ. We belong to Christ. We can go to the Father. Amen?
Amen.
So why are we worried about things in our lives? The Gentiles do. When you don't have a relationship with somebody, you're not sure that you could go to them. That's why it says the Gentiles act that way. Amen?
Amen.
We don't have to act that way. Have you ever been at a place at work where they give out free food and everybody seems to work their way down to get the free food? But when they have to pay for the food, they're not there?
Amen.
Right? Amen. Amen. Don't worry about it. God has your back. God has you. The unbeliever is not connected to the Father's economy.
You,
I'm here to tell you today that you and I as believers, we are connected to God's economy.
Amen.
The Bible tells us that my God shall supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
It doesn't matter if you have nothing in your pocket or your money stuffed with money. God has you in mind. God will supply all of your needs.
Hallelujah.
How many have ever lost a job? How many have ever, something is closed down, but you're saying, I know, I thank God for that job. But guess what? God, that job was my seed, but God is my source. Amen?
Amen.
And then I thank God for UPS. It provided a lot of things, but that was not my source. I know that God would open up another door for me
yes,
if something was to happen to me at UPS. Because my God is supplying all of my needs. God is taking care of me. I always tell the story of how I know God has taken care of me in this crazy life that I have lived, because I always wanted to be in management. I was actually pretty good at management. In 1985 and 86, I was employee of the supervisor of the month for 2.5 years. I was like the Lakers back in the 80s. I was showtime every year. I had jackets on, I had my wall full of supervisor of the month jackets everywhere. I was a part-time supervisor making full-time wages. They hired me to work full-time. And I was doing great, and I wanted to be there. In the 1990s, I had to go driving so I could come back to manage, because that was the only way you could get stock back in the company back then. And so what happened is I went out driving, and they said, we're going to pull you back in 3 months. We're going to get you back here in 3 months, 1991. And they kept delaying me because they didn't want to let me go. They finally let me go, and the economy went into like a recession, and they closed one of the ships down. And as I was driving in Whittier all over the place, and there's three kids and everything, and I would ask them, hey, when am I going to go back driving? When am I going to go back to supervision? And they said, oh, you're probably never going to go back because they closed that ship. I go, all right, no problem. No, I'll just do what I'm going to do. Well, let me tell you something. I worried about it for a month. I said, man, they're wasting my talent. They're wasting my talent. Mm-hmm. I can make it happen. Man, I would pat myself on the back so much I'd have to go get a neck rip every day. But you know, let me tell you something. I thank God that that happened. Because God knows what I was in need of.
Amen.
I got the route at my house. I delivered at my house every day for 25 years. And in that time, I had 2 children from there. My children were born at Whittier Presbyterian Hospital. My children went to school in the Whittier School District. My house was in Whittier. But most importantly, when they discovered that my son had special needs, I was there I would go to all the schools. Every school that my son was at, I delivered to. I could always check on him every day. I would creep in and peep into the thing, and I said, okay, he's good. I would never let him see me because then he'd want to come home with me. And so I'd check in and check out and go. And then in 2010, my wife, his mother, passed away. And I remembered that why so much I wanted to be in management, because I thought I was good. I knew I was good. I could make real good money, stock and everything. But then I realized, I thank God that God knew what he was doing in my life. He kept me driving so I could be there at 2 o'clock in the afternoon to get my son off the bus.
When I got him off the bus, I would have lunch with him for an hour and a half. And then my helper would come in to help me out while I took up and finished the route. And I would come back at 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock at night. And I did that for 7 years before I retired. Had I gone into management, I would be working every other shift. I would have been working in San Diego. I would be working in San Bernardino. I'd be working in Ontario. And I'm here to tell you that God knows what I have need of, even before I could ask. God took care of me. He knew what was going to happen in my life. And God supplied every one of my needs. So when you think that something didn't happen, that door shut in your life, God's going to open up the right door at the right time in your life. God will supply every one of your needs according to His riches and glory. Amen? When you think you're down and out, God's just getting started in your life. When you think, man, I mess up so much, God's going to turn that mess around. He's going to turn it into a message that you can stand for the honor and glory of God. Amen? Amen? And I'm here today to tell you that that's a testimony for my life. When I thought everything was lost in my life, how am I going to make it? God showed up. God made a way for my life. He took care of me. He took care of me. Even in the heartache and the pain, God took care of me. And I was so worried about things. But I had to remember that I was connected to God's economy. Watch here. Amen. It says, but seek, verse 33, it says, but seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things shall be added to you. Don't lose your testimony this morning. Don't lose your testimony. Stay strong in God. He says, therefore, do not worry about tomorrow. For tomorrow will worry about its own things. Sufficient for the day and has its own trouble. We lose joy when we compromise our faith in God. Why are you worried about tomorrow? Tomorrow is tomorrow. Today has its own trouble. How many know we have trouble today?
Yes.
Don't tell me you don't have no trouble. You're going to walk outside this door and have trouble, right?
Yes.
You're going to get into an argument with somebody when you say, what are we going to eat today? Oh, I feel like Mexican food. Ah. Oh, I feel like Italian food. Ah. Before you know, you're going to lose the whole blessing of coming to church today. Because the troubles of today are the troubles of today.
Amen.
But if you seek ye first the kingdom of God, in other words, you put God first. You acknowledge God in all your ways, and He's going to direct your path. You
Amen.
Put Him in front of you. You make Him everything in your life.
Amen.
And God will supply every one of your needs.
Amen.
You don't have to worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow will take care of itself.
Amen.
Today has its own troubles. How many know we have trouble today? Amen?
Amen.
There's troubles today. There's troubles today. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. Get after God. Go after God. Do what God called you to do each and every day.
Amen.
If you don't know what that is, that means saying, God, I don't know what that is to go after you. But Lord, show me how to go after you.
Amen.
Give me a heart that's after you. Show me my mind that wants to be clear and wants to go forward in your life. Show me what to do. If you don't know how to serve God, ask God to show you how to serve God.
Amen.
Ask Him. Man, tomorrow has its own troubles. Today, gas prices are $4.75. They're promising it's going to go up over $5, $6. What are you going to do about that? You're going to say, God, I don't know what's going on in this country, but I know that I'm on your economy. You're supplying every one of my needs according to your riches and glory. I'm not going to worry about what man is doing. I'm going to concentrate on what you called me to do. Amen? Because tomorrow has got its own trouble. Today, boy, woo! We are in trouble today. But God, I'm trusting you to supply all of my needs.
Amen.
Amen?
Amen.
When you look at that, I'm here to tell you, if God was to show you your whole life in front of you, would you say, God, I could deal with that? It'd be scary, huh? If God was showing you everything from the back to the front, but I'm here to tell you that God knows your end from the very beginning.
Amen.
God knows your end from the very beginning. He knows your rising. He knows your setting. He knows your failures. He knows your shortcomings. He knows everything. Guess what? He still loves you. He still cares for you. He still believes in you.
Amen.
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 Because he's the one that supplies your needs. And if God is guiding you, God will supply for you everything you're going to need for your life.
Amen.
Don't worry about tomorrow. Tomorrow's not promised.
Right.
Worry about today. Focus on today.
Yes.
Save that dollar. Save that $5. Put it away. It's going to add up in your life. Seek ye first the kingdom of God. You know what the word seek means? It means to pursue. How many got your girl next to you today?
Amen.
There had to be some pursuing, right? You had to seek after it. You had to examine what was going on. You girls, you were batting your eyes. You were crossing your legs. You were putting on that makeup. You were throwing on that perfume. Right? There was a whole lot of what? Preparation to go for that person to seek you out.
Amen.
Right? Brother Larry out there fixing his ponytail right there, getting right there. Well, oh, he was ready to go. Proverbs chapter 12, verse 25. What keeps us from getting to what God wants us to do is anxiety.
Amen.
Anxiety. We're so fearful, so we make a bad decision. When you make choices on your anxiety, you make bad choices. You make choices that are half-hearted. See, yesterday in that dealership, my pride could have said, oh, I can do it. I can. But I said, no. Because I'm not anxious. I went home and I kissed my 2008 and an 8 Yukon. I just hugged it. I said, baby, you and I have been faithful.
Man.
2008.
Man. Right.
You cost me nothing. That 2024, that basically out of that car is $96,000. Get me out the door.
Amen. Ouch.
Woo! And I walked out the, you know why? Because I wasn't anxious. I was excited, but I wasn't anxious. We make so many bad decisions when we have anxiety, when we have worry. When you worry about what everybody thinks of you, you make bad decisions. You make bad choices. But when you only concern yourself with what God thinks of you, you start operating in your God-given ability,
Amen.
Your God-given strength, your God-given purpose. Why?
Amen.
Because your eyes are on Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. Amen?
Amen.
God supplies your need. Amen?
Amen?
And the anxiety goes away from you. It says anxiety in the heart causes depression. You ever been depressed?
Amen.
Amen. You don't realize that you're on your fifth burrito and the Dodgers are only in the first innings. You don't realize why you're reaching for that 20th the Snicker bar and you're still in the crabby mood.
Ouch.
You know what people think? Well, I don't drink or smoke. Yeah, but you're king of the buffet line. I don't smoke the devil's till yeah, but you're beating your gums up with that chew in your mouth. Your nails look shorter than a typewriter in the 1940s. You guys gotta Google Bugs Bunny, baby. Come on, I didn't get that right. Right?
Yeah.
Right, you're anxious, right?
Yes, sir.
I have faith in God. The new one is oh, that takes over our anxiety is we're 24 hours on Facebook. 24 hours social media. We wake up. Why? Because that's anxiety. There's a spread of depression, anxiety. And all oppression comes. Because we're worried about everybody else. You're worried they better like my picture as you as you went through 40 filters to get the right picture. You don't even look like yourself no more.
Ouch.
You show up on a date, they're looking for the wrong person here. Where was that mullet that you had on top of your head? Hello, I had that on the filter there? Oh, man. I got to take that one off. Think about that. We look at the big things for depression. Anxiety leads to depression. That's why it says the anxiety in the heart causes depression. But what's this? It says, but a good word makes it glad.
Amen.
What is the good word today?
Jesus.
Jesus loves you. Amen.
Amen.
Jesus cares for you. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Anxiety. Anxiety in the heart causes depression. But a good word makes it glad.
Amen. Amen.
Woo! Hallelujah. Romans 10:17. So faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Every time I hear the word of God, I should be made glad. I should be made happy. I should be set free. Why? Because depression can't lodge itself there. Amen?
Amen.
Why? Because I don't allow anxiety to lead to depression in my life. Why? Because a good word. That's why when you come to church, I need to hear a good word from you. Pastor, it's good to see you today. Pastor, you're looking sharp today. Pastor, you know what? Give me a 3-hour sermon today. I can't get enough of the word you're
Amen.
Giving me.
Amen.
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 Amen. Woo! Pastor, I want to give an extra $100 today.
Hallelujah.
Just because God has been so good to me.
Amen, yes, sir.
Amen.
That's
Iota. Pastor, my kids came back home.
Amen.
Oh, they're not doing drugs no more. They're
Amen.
Trying to get off drugs.
Amen.
I want to hear that good word. Pastor, I got a job. I didn't think I could get a job, but God opened the door and gave me a job. Guess
Hallelujah.
What?
Hallelujah.
That makes my heart glad. Because
yes,
God's working on your behalf.
Amen.
Pastor, guess what? I haven't been able to sleep for a month or 2 months, but last night I had a full night's sleep. I got up with the joy
Amen.
Of the Lord in my heart.
Yes, sir.
Amen. Woo! Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Man, you're important when you come to church. You're important when you tell somebody what God has done in your life.
Amen.
You're important Amen. When you tell the truth to tell somebody, you know what? I'm going through something, but God's in control because I'm
Amen.
Not worried about tomorrow because God's taking care of today. Amen?
Amen.
You're important. You are important in what you do. Man, a good word. You ever talk to somebody at work that always has a sour word?
Yeah.
Man, is the sky blue today? Isn't that blue? It looked gray today. You know, isn't that bad? Nah. He's like, God, I'm sorry, you know? Like, sorry that your team sucks, you know? You know? Think about that. Think about how important a good word is in your life. Now, I'm not a sunshine pumper. Mm-mm. I don't pump sunshine where the sun don't shine. I tell you the truth.
Amen.
So when I tell you the truth, you should be glad because I love you enough to tell you the
Amen.
Truth. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. So it says, a glad heart gets when he hears a good word. A good word. Not a sugar-coated word. Not a flattery word. Not a word that makes you feel good, but you know it's not true.
Ouch.
It's like at a funeral. God bless you, my brother.
Always.
Amen. Amen. That's my brother. He works at the card shop. What's
record
it called?
Record shop.
He has a business that does frankincense. Frankincense,
oh, yeah.
They do memorabilia and all that good stuff.
Yeah.
So he helps out over there. It's like at a funeral. Have you ever known somebody at a funeral that you know they did not live a good life? And you got to come up with something good to say? It's tough to do, right? But it's like hearing that. So the pastor's very truthfully says, you know what, man, this guy was... He was the best murderer that I've ever seen. There's nothing good to say. I want to have something good to say. If I'm here after you leave this earth and your family says, hey, Pastor, come and say some few words, I'm going to say some good words about you. Amen. But you all ain't going anywhere, amen?
Amen.
You guys are going to be here another 100 years, right?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Watch this. Let's get to the other scriptures. We're going to get down in five, six more minutes. It says here, one, let's read the rest of us. 12:26. It says, the righteous choose his friends carefully. No wonder you're down and out. You got lousy friends. Says anxiety in the heart causes man depression, but a good word makes it glad. The righteous choose his friends carefully.
Amen.
If you have a big circle, you got a lot of fake friends. If you're popular by everybody, I was teaching a class today that the biggest wound in your life is a fake friend.
Yes, sir.
Right? It's tough when someone betrays you, right?
Yes, sir.
Right, it does. Say, oh, man, I thought you were my ride and die. No, they were my high and by. I thought you were my ride and die. All right, gone, right? And I've always told my children this. I said, it doesn't matter if nobody loves you. What matters is if your mom and dad love you.
Yep.
Amen.
Whatever you get from anybody else, that's just the icing on top. But know this, mom and dad are always love you. And once they get that foundation, they'll be able to face rejection. They'll be able to face two-timingness. They'll be able to go through all the fake friends.
Sure.
And know the foundation of what real love is, what real friendship is. So you want to be happy today? You want to get rid of your anxiety, your depression? Start choosing your friends wisely. That's what it says here. It says that the righteous chooses his friends carefully. For the way of the wicked leads them astray.
Yes, sir.
Wow. The way of the wicked leads. How many hang out with somebody in the world that don't come to this church? They're worldly. I guarantee you, you're more apt to go hang out with them than they are to come to church. So who's doing the persuading? Oh, they're up to go to a Dodger game. They're up to hang out at Johnny's Liquor or Ricky's Liquor Store or Johnny's Tequila. I was making the name. I don't know anything about this stuff.
Come on.
Devin's drinking house or whatever. I don't know. They're more up to hang out there than to say, hey, man, let's go to church. Hey, let's go to men's breakfast. Right?
Yes, sir.
See how difficult it is for them to come your way. But it's so easy for you to go their way, right?
Ouch.
Right? Think about it. So when you're choosing your friends, are they leading you to God? Are they leading you to godliness, holiness, and causing you to be in a place that you're not worried about anything because your faith is in God? Your faith is in Christ. You thank the Lord for the work of the cross. Is that where your life is at? Then you better choose your friends carefully, because the wicked ones will lead you astray.
Amen.
Philippians chapter 4, verse 6. Did you read that one today, Monica? Okay, she was teaching the class today. It says, be anxious for nothing. So what did we talk about in anxiety? Anxiety is worrisome. Being fearful for nothing. But in everything, by prayer and supplication. So what do we do? What do we do with anxiety and worry? We take it over to the Lord with prayer and supplication. The supplication is mixed in with worship that is brought with pain. That's a supplication. In your heartache, in your pain, you're making supplication. In other words, it's almost, I won't say begging, but you're very vociferous, you're very persuasive and persistent, saying, I'm going to go to you, God. I know what I'm feeling, but I'm going to go to you and I'm going to trust you this morning.
Amen.
It says, be anxious for nothing. In other words, don't worry about it. Don't care for nothing. Because God has your back.
Amen.
But in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your request be made known to God. In other words, give your petition to God. Verse 7 says, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding. Even when you don't understand what is going on, what in the Ben Franklin is going on with your money, you don't understand what in the Martin Luther King is going on with your freedom. All right. No matter what is going on, your mind, that's what it says here. And the peace of God, in other words, in the Hebrew, it's the shalom of God, the wholeness of God. It doesn't mean that everything is hunky-dory. It doesn't mean you don't have trials and tribulations. That word peace there doesn't mean tranquility. That word can mean two things. It can mean a tranquilizer. When you get knocked out, you're tranquil, and you don't feel anything. This word peace simply means no matter what's going on, no matter what is hitting me, there's a peace that goes beyond my understanding. I don't understand what's going on in my life, but my God is supplying every one of my needs according to His riches and glory. Every day I wake up, there's some food on my table, there's a roof over my head, there's some clothes on my back. Every day, I don't know how it's happening, but God, you're doing something in my life. Every day I wake up and my foot is sore and I can't walk sometimes. And I say, God, wake me up and let me walk a little bit more. And I can begin to walk. Why? Because my God is supplying every one of my needs. Amen?
Yeah.
Because of the peace of God which surpasses all understanding. How many love Jesus this morning?
Yeah.
But it's tough to explain to people.
Yeah.
Because you know why? Sometimes that love is so overwhelming. You don't know how to explain it. But guess what? It surpasses all understanding.
Amen.
The man, I don't know how to explain it. I just don't know. And you become like the man in John chapter 9. Remember that man that was healed from the time he was a child. God, Jesus healed him from birth of blindness. And they came up to him, and the Pharisees and everybody was questioning, hey, what happened to you? Oh, I don't. And they were saying, hey, that guy's bad. That guy's evil. And you know what he said? But I don't know anything. But there was a man named Jesus.
Amen.
He came and he touched my eyes. I was blind and now I see.
Hallelujah.
I don't know anything about Jesus,
Hallelujah.
But I'm blind. I was blind, but I can see now. Your life, you may not know anything. Why? Because His love, His peace surpasses all understanding. And all you can say is, I know one thing. Jesus came into my life and
Amen.
He changed my life.
Hallelujah.
He gave me peace. When there was no peace, He gave me joy. When there was no joy, He gave me hope. When I was hopeless,
yep. Amen.
That's the peace of God which surpasses all understanding. You can't figure it out. You can't explain it. All you know is if it wasn't for God, you'd be dead right now. Amen.
Amen.
You'd have no purpose in your life. And it says here, but the peace of God which surpasses. What does that word surpass mean? It means to overthrow, to go above and beyond. Surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
Amen.
And you've got to guard. The Holy Spirit will guard your heart and mind in Christ Jesus. But you've got to be at attention what you allow in your life.
Yes, sir.
If you're allowing fear to come in your life, you need to guard your mind. You need to guard your heart. Because the love of God, which surpasses all understanding,
Amen.
Will guard your heart. And mind
yes.
in Christ Jesus. We got some more verses today, but I don't want to run through them. We'll preach on this, finish up next week, talking about seeking God, staying close to God. Brother David, come on up. Unless you're going to hold the baby, then you can hold the baby. As we get ready for communion. Actually, let's remember to Isaiah 41:10. And we'll read those verses as we get going. I'm here to tell you today that. He missed that enough. It says, fear not. Fear not, for I'm with you. Robert, go ahead and pray for the thing you guys can start coming. It says, fear not, for I'm with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous hand. Okay? So today, fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God.
That all ties into Matthew 6:33, right?
Amen.
Seeking God and his kingdom, and all these things shall be added to you. Anxiety causes depression. James 4:8. Mary, do you have that one? It says, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you.
Sure.
Cleanse your hands, you sinner, and purify your hearts, you double-minded. As we go to have communion today, ask the Lord, Lord, clear my mind. I want to be single-minded. I want to be single-purpose in my life. That's what he's talking about. He said, I want to be single-minded. I don't want to go back and forth. One day I'm trusting you, God. One day I believe in you. And the next day, I'm back to doing my old thing. Right? So it says, draw near to me. Purify your mind, you double-minded. And it says, cleanse your hands. You know what it means by that? Cleanse your hands. It means that the cleansing of your hands is your conscience. Is your conscience. See, because what your mind does, your conscience does, it tells your hands how to act out. How to feed. That's why it says your hands are not necessarily dirty in the spiritual realm. Your mind is dirty, or your heart is dirty. So your mind gets your hands to do what? To do dirty things, to get them corrupted. So when he says, come to God, draw near to God, cleanse me of my hands, cleanse my hands, purify my heart, you double-minded. That's what he's saying. So today, as we have communion, as we get ready for communion, and how many love my father, but I was given instructions. He's still on probation for gambling like Wakami. We got to figure it out. He can't get into the game just yet. No, he hasn't been given clearance from Albuquerque for the minor leagues used to be for the dog, but he'll be joining us soon to do communion. But that's what it's about. Anxiety leads to depression. Faith in the Word of God leads to victory, leads to strength, leads to hope, leads to confidence, leads to peace, which you don't understand, right? How many want to grow in Christ?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Someone gave a good scripture today. I think Sister Monica, she did a double winter day. She talked about the mustard seed, right? The mustard seed. The mustard seed starts out very small. When that mustard seed gets a hold, it takes over everything.
Man,
that's the story of the mustard seed. It takes over everything. I want your faith to take over everything.
Yes, sir.
I want the faith like my mother had. I want that faith. I'm growing in that faith. I always can remember her slapping me on the top of my head. Omijito, have faith in God. Have faith in God. Where's your faith, Omijito? Where's your faith this morning? What hinders us is our little faith. Say, well, Pastor, I have little faith. Start little. I already gave you plenty of things to help you along the way. Get rid of your lousy friends. Cut them off. If they're speaking junk into your life, get rid of them. Say, you know what? I'll keep you in my Rolodex. That's old school. Rolodex, right? Okay. I'll keep you as a friend on Facebook. I won't unfriend you, but I want to see less of you on Facebook. You're not on my favorites on my phone. I'm using these all as examples. You know what you need to cut off in your life. Because the world is always going to keep coming after you. Time and time again. The world does not quit. And so when you have these tools, man, it says, when I hear a good word, my heart is beating. How many heard a good word today?
Amen.
You're happy today. You're happy because you know the truth. and the truth is setting you free.
Amen.
Let's all stand today. Father, in the name of Jesus, Father, I give myself to you, Lord, as we get ready for communion. Father God, right now, I want you to say, God, I want to get closer to you. God, bring me closer to you. I don't want to take this communion unworthily. I want to take it worthy of you. How am I to be worthy by the blood of Jesus Christ? I'm only worthy because of the blood of Jesus. Okay? So right now I say, God, everything that's happened to me, I give it to you right now. I ask you to take over and have your way in my life. Cleanse me, wash me. In Jesus' name, I'm going to participate today worthy of being your child. In 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, it says, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'Take, eat. This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" Remember that his body was broken for you. He was put to shame for you. Every guilt that you would ever face, everything that you would be accused of rightfully, you belong. That sin was given to you justly. That sentence was properly given to you. Jesus' body was broken. Then by his stripes, you are healed. Take the bread. In the same manner, he also took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do often as you drink it, and in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." This cup represents the work of the cross. It represents the blood. The Bible says, without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sins. We're not forgiven if Jesus didn't die on the cross. Remember last week we talked about Peter saying, "Jesus, you're not going to die." And Jesus said, "Satan, get behind me." If Jesus didn't die, we would be lost.
Sure.
So thank the Lord that Jesus went to the cross. He was buried and he rose again on the day. Take the cup. Let's worship the Lord. And as we get ready to go,
give us clean hands, give us a pure heart. Let us not lift our souls to another. Give us clean hands, give us a pure heart. Let us not lift our souls to another. Oh God, let us be a generation that seeks your face, oh God, of Jacob. Oh God, let us be a generation that sees your face, oh God, of Jacob.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Let's be a generation that seeks God, that goes after God, that loves God, that knows God and knows his love. If you're struggling in any area of your life, remember that God loves you. We're the people of God. We build each other up. We help each other along the way. With that saying, if you need food here today, if you need something that I can do, the church can do, come see me after church and we would love to help you if we could possibly do that. Remember, Wednesday night Bible study coming out. If we invite everybody that comes to this church, this building would be blown out. Think about it. This church is awesome. You guys are amazing. We don't get into fights over things. We don't play politics. We just love one another. Amen. We have a few. We have a few Bruin fans, or few Cowboy fans.
Yeah. Oh, that's worse.
But guess what? We're all bought under the blood of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
We all love the Lord. Amen. Amen. And let's take care of each other. With that, what I want to do is next week or this week, I want you, if you don't have my phone number, if I don't have your address, I want to get a roster of all the names of all the ladies and men so I can send out everything that we have for our website and everything that we have going so you know exactly what we're doing. And if you have YouTube, I want you to like and follow, subscribe that channel, share that channel. We're reaching people out there, but if we can get to a bigger number, we can get support financially from them. We got a ways to go, but this is a good church. I love this church. I really do. Not because of anything, because of you guys. Because you guys are pure in that sense of like, you guys, I mean, every day I just go home, and like you used to tell my brother Marcos, all we gotta do is preach the word and live right before them. We're not gonna be perfect, but we got something good here.
Amen.
And I don't ever want to mess it up.
Amen.
So with that said, I'm gonna go buy my new car. No, I'm just gonna go. Father, in Jesus' name, take us from this place. Help us to be the people you call us to be. Father God, bless us and give us traveling mercies. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Real quick, if you don't have, let's get a piece of paper going and